obviously, you all are in the process of defining for yourself what architecture is. For me, architecture is an interest in how form and program can produce new possible lifestyles in the city. As architects, that's our expertise, I think, is form. We do it really well. We don't necessarily do other things really well, like engineering or economics or politics, but we can be maybe pretty good approximators. But what we're really best at, I believe, is form and manipulating the program to produce new possibilities. I myself use techniques of aggregated difference, and I like to experiment with figure and with field, and sometimes both at the same time. And the way I do this is, both in studio and in my practice, is I ask a series of what if questions. So what if this were like this, then I'll sort of play out that scenario. And how I came to this started in the 90s, before the first years here were born, probably. It's very sad. So in the 90s, I worked for a time as the lowest intern in Stephen Hall's Stephen Hall was an architect in his office. And my job as the lowest intern, not even architect, was I was responsible for inking, and you guys don't even know what that is. That's when you have a pen and it's very calibrated and you sort of draw. This is before Illustrator. So I was responsible for inking every drawing in this book. So I wasn't drawing them, I was just copying them. And then we had presentations, so 6 days a week, because we worked on Saturdays too, it was required. All day, every day, I drew every road in Dallas, Fort Worth, Texas. I did every road in Phoenix, all the drawings for Cleveland. And so as I was doing that, and maybe what is interesting about inking drawings is that it's copying. And you don't have to actually necessarily be that present in the moment, you just have to sort of get into a groove. But maybe you're actually a little bit present, and what happens is all of this copying maybe gets a little bit internalized. And so looking back, I realized that during all this drawing, all these hours of drawing, I became, or since then, I've become very interested in exactly what the book itself is about. And it is about architecture in the city. So all the projects in my book, called The Edge of the City, leverage the organization of the city, program and form, in order to create new architectural forms and new ways to live. Although Stephen Hall doesn't really kind of talk about it exactly in those terms, but that's what I believe the book is about. And so what started in the 90s now continues today, and what I'm working on right now is my own book at Urban Lab about how we at Urban Lab speculate about new possibilities for architecture and the city. And we do that, as I said, by asking a series of questions. So, for example, each project begins with a question like, what if a building could stop sprawl while creating new possible lifestyles in the city? And one, this is the project. We call it this. It is about the United Center in Chicago. So, for example, this project starts with this problem of the void space around the United Center over time. So someone's head is right there on the lower right. There we go. So here we start in 1938. There's a very little void space. Thanks for moving your head. Then it's growing. It's turning into parking lots. It's getting really big now. Here it is in 2011 when we started thinking about the project. So the sprawl in this case is not typical sprawl that you can think about in the suburbs where everything is sprawling. But in this case, it used to be a dense neighborhood, and what is kind of taking over is a sort of sprawl of void space, of programmed void space that is parking. It's particularly insidious because as it spreads, we believe that it's reducing the property value of the spaces immediately adjacent to it. It's valuable in itself as parking, but spaces immediately adjacent become maybe less valuable if they're looking at parking. So our proposal, and this is kind of one of our techniques, is to sort of go back and forth between figure and field. At this urban scale, we're trying to produce a figure, in this case, like a robot-y Michael Jackson kind of guy, that it becomes a kind of line beyond which parking cannot extend, because it's basically a boundary. It's made out of a kind of aggregation of different types of three-flat type of proposals that we make as differentiated as possible, because when they aggregate, they can become new types of fields and can house different types of programs. So the programs in one patch might be different than the programs in another patch. Then we play that what if out, like what if you actually built a kind of wall building that was a growth boundary for parking, then what could you get? Here's the line around the parking, extruded up as a wall, and then populated by all of the different characters of three-flat. The parking still stays in the middle, but since the United Center is a winter sport stadium, the summer is available, so potentially the new possible lifestyles that could also be produced on the exterior could be possibly the city's largest temporary farm, or the city's largest campground, or the city's largest pool. You're supposed to laugh there. So other projects go along the lines of this. We have a kind of multiple scales in the office. We think about things that we were not hired to think about, and we also think about things that we are hired to think about. In both cases, we don't make any money. So this is a thing that we started thinking about ourselves, which is what if infrastructure was hybridized in order to solve flooding and create new public space. So this was a couple years ago in Chicago when we had this fabulous Marilyn Monroe sculpture. She was able to shelter a few people in a very large 100-year storm, which happens every other year now. So you might not know this, but 100 years ago, Chicago reversed the Chicago River. For sanitary reasons, we were dumping all of our dirty water into the river, and it was flowing into Lake Michigan, which is where we were pulling out all of our clean water. So we realized 100 years ago that was not going to be a very good idea. We reversed the river. We connected it with a series of channels to rivers that connected to the Mississippi. So now we've connected Lake Michigan to the Gulf of Mexico. Recently, we still have flooding problems and sanitary problems, so we started building these giant holes in the suburbs where we can house those rain events, basically the rain that happens in these events. And these are very cool giant holes, but they're just giant holes that only a few people really get to experience, these two guys. Our thought is that if you're going to build a lot of infrastructure, if you're going to think big, I mean, if you're going to think about big infrastructure, why do you think big infrastructure that can be leveraged into new public space? So if we were to, for example, dam the river in a couple of locations and allow it to flow back into Lake Michigan, we would have to clean the water before it came into Lake Michigan, because we don't want the same sanitary issues. But we could do that in a kind of new public space. So what we proposed is what we call Filter Island, which is this giant water cleaning park that also can have other types of programs that are more socially organized and oriented. We looked at the history of Chicago, which includes Burnham's plan, 1909 plan. So Chicago has been thinking about leveraging infrastructure for at least 100 years. Burnham thought about new infrastructure of roads and highways and trains in order to create a kind of new lakefront. So he also leveraged. So we kind of position this in relationship to him and think about how to clean the water, how the water flows, what are the other programs that you could insinuate into that plan, and how that might work. This is a program time. Again, you see kind of difference in aggregation. Zooming in, playing out the scenario even further, looking at the plan. And so the effect, this is when it's a rainy day. You see it's kind of flooded at the south end of the, actually the whole thing is a bit flooded. And the rain event is being taken care of in the park. And then on a sunny day, it might look like that. We participated in the Chicago Biennial, so we like to, we use kind of any means that we have at our disposal to get these ideas out to the public, especially when they're not really solicited by the city. This is a zoom of the model. So all the kind of funny schmoo things are the public program, and then the blue is obviously the water, obviously getting cleaned. And then we look like even bigger at even larger problems like climate change and rising sea levels, and seeing if this is completely sort of a project that is never going to be built, but it's still interesting to us to kind of think it through. So what if you were to actually flood Death Valley in order to produce a new series of kind of LA/Vegas lifestyles that would happen in the desert by taking sea water and pumping it into various depressions in the west, and then living next to that aqueduct that you would produce in order to move the water, what the kind of new possible lifestyles would be that would come along with that. Looking backwards to historic projects like the megastructure projects in the 50s and 60s, and blatantly referencing them. Looking at what kinds of urban forms we could create in them, like city, and so looking at the difference that you could create in a kind of city formation, which is a more vertical formation, and the different types of spaces and programs that you could get out of that. This goes on for a while, so looking really specifically at the different, in this case, the different residential typologies that would go into that new form, both in axonometric section and plan, looking especially at the public space that might be created, looking at the architecture, looking at all sorts of typologies like town, and how that is different from the city, and what kinds of effects that you would create. More flat, so we've gone from super vertical to super horizontal. And looking kind of at a new type of suburb that might emerge with new types of lifestyles and capitals. And then we also do what you might be more familiar with in terms of architecture, so a sort of smaller scale. And we try to say that it's kind of a weird stretch to think about testing those ideas at the smaller scale, but we do our best. And so this project and the next three, two are houses, or this one's live work, and the other two are pure houses. And just thinking about, again, sort of leveraging one thing for another, so this is leveraging kind of existing condition of a problem, so a building that needs to be demolished, taking that problem and turning the demolition of an old building into a new landscape that the new building uses. So the old building is now in that big mound. The old building becomes poche, and the new building uses it. So the second floor of the building then is able to kind of have a direct connection to the landscape in that case, and working it through. So we're also interested in space and materials. We're interested in landscape, although we're bad gardeners. looking at construction and how to kind of optimize construction in order to achieve the effects that we're interested in this case, the kind of new space in between the main space and the kind of exterior wall. And what ultimately what we're really interested in is in the kind of space that results, in this case, this. This is a house that we did a couple of years ago. Again, sort of leverage of a particular moment. In this case, the desire to kind of locate a space right at the edge of two landscapes and use both at the same time, which leads to literally a kind of plan that sort of acts in order to kind of capture both sides and really looking at the ways to kind of take a pretty simple idea and hold it as a kind of diagram that needs to be adhered to and kind of supported and tested throughout the process. So in all the black spot space is the kind of private area, and the zone here is in outside, inside, and outside, but considered to be one kind of flowing landscape idea that changes from woodland to prairie. And then thinking about that literally as the way to kind of wrap that interior. This is the interior of that space unfolded, and then the result is this kind of space that is part of the woodland and part of the prairie. And in order to make that really clear, we work really hard on details that most people think are not worth it, but that's to like make this door completely disappear, so when you're in this publicly oriented space, you don't feel the private space at all. It's totally hidden. And also extending to the outside so that those outside spaces are veiled in some way with this perforated corrugated facade. So there's the corrugated perforated facade in front of the private zone, and this is the public zone. And then the effects of that veil on the inside are really interesting and change throughout the day. And this is the last project I'll show, which is still in construction, which brings up another issue that we have in architecture, which maybe other people don't have. I showed the project to about a year and a half or 2 years ago to the same kind of Tuesday episode, and it's like at the same point. So it's really slow, especially if you have a family member as your client who's building it himself. So this house is in LA, and it's on the side of the hill. And what's really interesting about LA and hills is that you can kind of live in the hill. Most people live lightly on the hill. But we wanted really to kind of dig in and live in the hill. So this model that we did really early on is still the basic diagram for the house, which is in sort of excavating this space. It becomes an inside-outside space, which since it's LA, is usable all year long. And above, the piece that kind of gets excavated up is the private space of the house, like the bedrooms and the bathrooms. And these are a series of plans as you go kind of up the hill. And we looked a lot at the kind of potential for sort of making that upper level as kind of solid and private as possible. The ground floor, the garage functions actually as a gallery rather than a garage. This is the stairs we walk up. What's not done is this facade. Don't look at it, it's really ugly. This is the space that we're really interested in, sort of LA style, like living inside, outside. The line inside and outside is often not clear. So we have finished the inside, and we are still working on installing the veiled metal skin above. I thought we might beat the road to finish, but we didn't. Slower than they are. This is we like to actually design build. So we designed this stair and had it fabricated, and then designed this, sourced this netting from a tennis netting company as a kind of handrail. There's a rule that you'll find out about, 4-inch rule. So how do you kind of leverage rules in order to actually produce new possibilities? That's the stair going down. And so we are at, here, trying to make this happen soon so that we don't have to look at this. Thank you.
Developer who had it before, who wanted to kind of flip it, but did the numbers.
didn't work out. So, yeah, it, people had been thinking about building on it for about 20 years, but they hadn't. But it is permitted. Any other questions? This, actually, the permit process in LA was way nicer than here. There were way, way nicer people, much more helpful. So if anybody ever ends up working for the city in the building department, I would like you to be much nicer and more helpful. Please. Yeah?
I was
going
to ask, how did that
Well, the part of the reason why this is a complicated site is because LA has hills, and it's they have this thing called the hillside ordinance, which means that you have to do special work in order to to build. So all of these old houses actually probably would just stay until they fall down because the rules of building new on hills in LA are very strict. So actually, one of the reasons people don't do what we did is because it's expensive to kind of dig a foundation. So essentially, this is almost like, it's not really a basement, but you're living, this is the foundation wall. So we're kind of using what often gets covered up or isn't seen as like an amenity. So we think it looks nice. We think that this wall looks cool, and we really like seeing this moment here, where the hill is literally keeps going up. That's the ground right outside the window. So we think that's really beautiful. But you have to be careful that the foundation wall is actually poured nicely because it's what you're going to look at. So I think the process of permitting and zoning wasn't a big issue. It's more controlling the construction so that it came out well, so that it would look good. Yeah?
So a lot of these projects have to do with sort of like sculpting and molding the landscape, or at the very least sort of drawing inspiration from the landscape.
Uh-huh.
Each of those projects have very different contexts and immediate surroundings. If you were to describe your mindset in approaching like the landscape around the site you're building and sort of like what you draw from it, like how would you describe that?
Well, I think maybe we treat it equally to the kind of more standard architectural form, that it can be manipulated and leveraged as much as kind of building form can be. We made a hill in Chicago where it was flat, and then we made a flat in LA where it's hilly. So maybe we're also a little bit perverse about, we'll just do the opposite of what's there. In order to make, I think by cutting into the landscape, in my opinion, it makes the landscape even more kind of present and more clear and more obvious. And we're really looking at the kind of beautiful quality of that, very steep hill where most houses in LA just sort of sit on top of it and don't really, they just try to kind of not deal with it. So, yeah, I think we're trying to play off its possibilities. Yeah?
Since it's open, do you find a lot of wildlife going into that house? Or do you have anything to prevent against wildlife?
No, we don't. There are coyotes in the neighborhood. No coyotes in the house yet. The cat does not exist anymore. But the cat was going to get eaten even if the cat lived in a fortress, because the cat wasn't very smart. We did design and build this sort of after this photo. There's a fence on this side now that we designed and built. And on the other side, it's still an ongoing conversation with my brother about what the fence should be on the other side. A lot of conversations.
Yeah.
was it like working with your brother as a client?
It's hard. But it's good. He's really, he turns out to be a really good contractor. But very slow. Like, he's built really, really nicely. But it's really slow. But the details are really nice. I mean, we drew them all and designed them, and he executed them, and we were on the phone with him, like, multiple times a day. Never built anything before. But I think there's a kind of trust that maybe you wouldn't have working with somebody who doesn't know you. But it's not typical. I don't think you should, like make that your business plan. Unless you have a really big family and not a lot of money. Any other questions? Okay, thank you.